Okay, do we have anybody here tonight? Do we have seven here tonight? Are any, and I'm having trouble keeping up with all the sports. I mean, I did the devotion for the Saxony High School girls this morning for them to go off to their state champ game today. And but now are Trinity boys doing anything today or?
You aren't, and
you don't do nationals until
March 27th through the 30th.
March.
Volleyball was like they had like a required practice today. I think it was like for a game, like a practice for a game or something. It was like.
And Eddie, what did you do? You won.
Did you win state?
They're
going to nationals also.
Trinity, both of them. Who else was on that? Anybody else in here on that team? Okay.
Girls cool. have won it before, but it's the first time in the history of Trinity boys. School that boys have.
And boys have won?
Yeah.
All right, bring me back.
Yeah. Do you mind if you, because I'm going to trip over that bag and walking back and forth if you don't mind.
That's for sure. Where should we bring the check for the gown?
On Tony's desk. Why don't you leave it right here and help me remember to take it when I, at the end of class, we have several.
I have one too.
Michelle was thinking about it, and I thought it was a good thought.
Okay. You know where to put it, don't you? Put it on Tony's desk. Maybe put it, if her little lap drawer will open it and just lay it right inside her drawer. That lap drawer, a little flap drawer. So it's not quite sleeping Orlando. What's that about? I'm reading your shirt.
Oh, Sleeping with Sirens. That's a band.
Oh, Sleeping with Sirens. Okay. Okay. Shows how much I know. Keep it up. Okay, so. Next week is a regular Wednesday, and everybody's here next week. Is that right? Does that sound right?
All right. Take care of the dog. She's really sick.
She's
just waking up for me to see. She's.
Should I just put her out or something?
No, she's all goofy.
I sounds set with her.
March. So we trot along. We've got class tonight, March 12th. Is that right? I'm on the right day? Okay.
Yeah.
Then next week is March 19th. Pastor Mark preaches, I don't. That's a good thing. And then March 26th, teach confirmation service. I preach that night. Same like, I guess. And then we get to April. That's in an April 2nd, there is a serving event. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. No. I believe there is. And it's new.
Because we did our serving event. We switched it
for Christmas.
Yeah.
For Christmas cards, and then we did a fellowship. We swapped.
We were supposed to have done our fellowship. When you were gone, and we made up a snow day instead.
Yes. But we got permission.
Because technically today should have been a fellowship event. Our sermon event would have been February 12th, and then our fellowship would have been March 12th.
Yeah, because I am gone April 2nd. I believe Jim Hicks talked about his class having a sermon event or something, fellowship that night. And then we meet again on the 9th, and that will be our night of rehearsal, right?
Mm-hmm.
And party. So I need to check out because I am at Food for the Poor headquarters on April 2nd, is what the plan is now. And I hated missing that class, and Jim looked and said, because it looked like there was another sermon event coming up. Why? And so, but none of you know anything about that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, it said, on my yellow sheet, it said that it should have been tonight, the 12th, but we'd swapped ours earlier on.
That's what
on
you swapped out. So in your mind, you've done that.
Yes.
Okay.
Because we swapped our fellowship for our service.
So what would we do constructively on the 2nd? Because I think we're going to finish our review. And I'm thinking the 26th, we're going to have a fun kind of wrap-up quiz in class. Fill, you know, paper, pencil, take a quiz. We had a lot of fun with it last year. And then April 2nd. Come in, Macy. Let me just go look at the, see if I see anything on the calendar in here. While we're talking about schedules. I have an incredibly clear answer to the confusion.
Okay.
During the confirmation class on Wednesday, April 2nd, we will be filling Easter eggs for the church Easter egg hunt. We being... It would be a great help if you could bring with you two class that night, a package of plastic eggs, and a bag of individually wrapped candy.
Each person.
Okay.
So. Got it. Oh, that's not bad. I like it. Here. I mean, some tape.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Okay, well,
you bring some tape, I'll bring some tape.
Yeah, because we always, you know.
I'll make sure
tossing.
The guides get this. And then we'll communicate this.
Okay. That's a great idea.
You're welcome. Then I'll spread these around so y'all can. Yeah, you've already got one.
Yeah.
You got one. Hunter. So that, does this help a little bit?
Yeah, that sounds like fun.
Cool. And we're on camera, so if you're looking at this, April 2nd is a servant fellowship event where the two confirmation classes are going to help fill Easter eggs for the children's Easter egg hunt. So, yes. Maggie?
It'll be at 5 o'clock?
5 o'clock, I would. And I'm sorry I didn't say that, but that would be my total assumption. So everybody's good?
No. Can I have one?
I don't have one.
Like it.
Make sure you show these to your parents so that they know what to do. Did you get one?
Yes.
Do you need one?
Yes.
Oh, you got one. Okay, good. Can you all help each other with that? That's all I've got. They didn't quite. Yeah. I can make more copies if I need to. All right. So that solves.
I got it written down.
Okay. That solves April 2nd. So I won't miss, you know. So we're going to work around that. So the Wednesday before, we'll have our final review. The Wednesday after, we'll have rehearsal. And you'll also be rehearsing your, reading your essay that night as well, in front of a mic, I believe, so that you won't be. I need to also go get your essays. Okay, who did not get one of these that needs to take it home?
I know, but I got one.
Got one? Tell that to your mom.
My brother has Miss Green as a teacher for all my essay, and she like wrote it.
Okay. Let me go get. I'll be right back.
Little trash bag.
How are you doing?
You're like,
were you at a wedding this past week?
Oh, being black.
Yes.
But everybody brings. I got a Walmart bag and stick it back in.
Yeah, probably.
I talked to them.
Don't throw it away.
But I can bring a big black bag.
Yeah.
Whatever you want.
It doesn't
matter. I put tape.
Yeah.
I guess a large one, actually. Right? I have some trash bags at the dog's
room. Okay, we have corrected, not the exact word, but we have essays with notes from Ms. Green. Her notes are kind of in green, and mine are kind of in blue. If there are any on there. Maggie, step down.
She had to return her fork.
Oh, returned your fork. There you are.
Maggie, on April 2nd, we're bringing Easter eggs.
I think she got that.
Oh, okay.
I think she was here.
Oh, I was
thank you. I've read every one of yours. I have a general comment to make that might be helpful.
I got the email.
Okay. She didn't return it to you?
No, I didn't. I never got anything back. I never got a response to that.
So I wonder if it went to the right email address.
Hope it did.
Did you? And you emailed it to her. You didn't give it to me. You emailed it to her?
Yeah, I emailed it to her last year.
It's at laura.green58.
Let me see if that's what I wrote down.
At gmail.com. Now, I would recommend that you would... Okay, here is my general comment.
Not that I forgot the 58.
Okay. laura.green...
Yeah, I have that. I did have
58@gmail.com.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. We'll do that tonight. I'm sure she'll be right on. She had these back to us like Monday. I gave them to her Sunday in worship, and she had them back Monday morning on my desk. Wow. She's always very good about that. Well, it seems like a year ago since I read these, and I read these Monday morning, actually. Some of you kind of talked in general, rather than talking about yourself. You stated facts about faith, about, you know, some of you kind of rehearsed a few confirmation facts, but you didn't say anything about you and your faith. And that's really what we're looking for. You don't need to tell us about what the catechism book says. And most of you didn't put in a string of Bible verses. Every now and then we have somebody that does that. That never quite works. By the time we get to the third one, we're going, okay, need to back up and redo this whole thing. But you really want to try and talk about your faith in your own life. And wherever you can give an example of that, ever how simple it might seem to you, whenever you take your faith and give a personal story, it really helps other people to capture your thoughts. And your thoughts can kind of help them pick up, well, that's how I feel too. All right, I never thought about that. And several of you did that, and some of you didn't. So I'm just saying it in general. And every now and then I maybe would have put a note like, give an example. I noticed Ms. Green also said, give us an example. And something that we always try and stress at St. Andrew is, can you find a way with, when you're talking about your faith, to share that with other people? So you're going to see Ms. Green has given that as a comment at the bottom for a lot of you. Can you give an example how you would share this with other people? And sometimes you can just kind of talk about how you would do that. That you would be open with your faith, and you would be open with, even when you're having struggles. You don't always have to, you know, Christians don't always have the answers. A lot of people know that. One of my common answers is, I don't really have a good answer for that. Or sometimes I'll say, I think I can find the answer for that. I don't know it, but give me a chance to try and find the answer to that. Particularly if somebody's saying, do you have a verse that deals with... And as time goes by, I seem to have more verses just because the library in my head begins to load up, the repertoire, it loads up. And then I have the issue of memory. My memory's like my last name. Short. And I don't mind telling people I don't know. I'm comfortable with that. But I sometimes can say, I don't know, but let me see if I can find out. Sometimes I'll check with other people, or I'll run to Google. Google's amazing. Google sometimes doesn't know any more than I know. But Google doesn't know. Who knows, right? And then also, when it's just issues of life and faith and trying to figure all that out, sometimes we don't always have a good answer for that. And my answer sometimes is, where reason and understanding stops, faith begins. That's where faith comes in. And that's Hebrews 11:1. You know, faith is seeing and trusting in those things that we can't see, hoping for those things. You know, faith is sometimes not always knowing how it's going to turn out, and we sometimes stand on the edge of the cliff of life, the edge of the cliff of the unknown. We're not, you know, we're, whether it's starting a new grade in school, or starting a new class, meeting a new friend, taking a test that we have no idea if we're ready for, we're scared of it. Maybe we've studied, but we're still not sure. And sometimes you have to jump off the cliff before your wings begin to grow. I'm not talking about angel wings, I'm talking about, you know, wings to get us, you know, to where we're trying to soar to. If we wait for everything to be right and perfect, we will never jump. We'll never jump. And God kind of says, come on, jump. Trust me. Not to be foolish with things in life, but to give our life to Him and trust. And to trust that He's loving us, even with all of this. So try and make that personal in your essay. Try and use your own words to do it. A couple of you did that and did a good job of that. I maybe didn't stroke some of those enough where I could have done that. Because I had a little bit of time to read. But thank you for working on these. And okay, who did everyone get an essay back tonight? Okay, Morgan, I know you didn't, but you're taking care of that. Okay, anybody else did not get one back tonight? Everybody's good? So we're caught up with that, right? Any questions that you have of what you're looking over? Okay, so if you would take these tonight and bring your new ones back next week. You see where I'm headed with this? We're going to get this done so you can... Okay, that's done, right? And we're going to give you a chance to kind of like, you know, I'm writing a book, and I was like, I'm still on my first draft, and I dread going back and working on a next draft. I dread it, absolutely dread it. It's almost keeping me from the farther I write, the more I have to go back and work on. And I'm not far enough along as a writer to just hand it to somebody and say, fix it. Writers get to that point. My friend John Maxwell, and I can call him my friend now, has written 79 books. Well, after you've written about 50 books, you can just, okay, here's my first draft, fix it. And he's got people that fix it. I don't know if I'll ever get to that point. Do you know the name of my book? I mean, it's up in the upper right-hand corner of my laptop. You know, don't you, Doug? You don't know the name? You don't know the name of my book?
No.
Religion is not worth the hassle. But a personal relationship with Jesus is worth all the hassle. So the ones of you that nailed personal relationship in your essay, yes, yes! Personal relationship. You know, describe a relationship with the best friend you could ever have, who you know would never let you down, would never disappoint you, would never hurt you. Describe a relationship, and that's Jesus. Describe how that feels for you. And if you don't have that relationship, let me know. I think I could help you with that. I will tell you, I don't think I had it as a 7th grader. I don't think I had it as an 8th grader. I don't think so. I think I had the religion part down. Because I can tell you no one in this class has the catechism memorized as well as I did. No one. Because you could ask me any question on that catechism book, and I had the answer and the Bible verses that went with it. But I didn't have a relationship with Jesus. That makes sense? You can have a bunch of head knowledge about the facts of the Bible and have no relationship with Jesus. And that messed me up later. Because I confused faith with church. I confused a relationship with Jesus with going to church and being in a church. And that really messed me up later. That's the reason I left the church. For a couple of years, maybe a little over 2 years, and then I was ambushed back. You think you're away from the church? I'll show you how far away from the church you really are, Paul. So here we are. You never know. Any thoughts about that? Any questions about that? That doesn't mean you cannot have a relationship. part of our concern as we teach confirmation and as we do things here at St. Andrew is to help try and get beyond some of the church stuff, some of the religion stuff, and to talk about a one-on-one relationship that Jesus wants to have with you. Okay? Yes, sir.
Do you know what this says? Because I cannot read it.
Read that.
This?
With revisions.
Mm-hmm. Sent email to Don's email address with revisions. So she has your comments on an email list to you. I guess you would check your email and you must have something from Laura Green.
I'll find it in a second.
Yeah. Send email to Don's email address with revision. So she didn't put any revisions on here, but it's on the email.
Okay.
So that must be the one that she, that y'all emailed to her, and she gave me that hard copy with the note that the revision went there, so just check email and it should be there. Cool. Any questions, thoughts? Does any stuff that I've said make any sense? Sort of? A little bit? Yeah? A little bit? That's the reason I think sometimes the stuff that we call, you know, religion is, are the things that we do with church and going through the motions and memorizing the Bible and catechism, which we try and work, we want you to do, but if that's as far as we go, we haven't worked with your faith life in Jesus. All right. You may want to Google a song called My God and I. It became a favorite hymn of mine. And I still fall back on it a lot. Go through the fields together. We go through life and all its common trifles. My God and I. So, okay? So we are dealing with Holy Communion. We were looking at the sacraments, the institution, the Lord's Supper. We're looking at number, I believe. Did we answer number 13? Where in the Bible is Christ institution? When I use the word institution, does that make sense? What does institution mean? Anybody know? Kind of wonder, you know, where do you find the institution on the Lord's Supper?
Not sure it's
26. Okay, it's where Jesus is giving Holy Communion to his disciples. Where that's done. Remember, we said it's in three of the Gospels, and it's in where else? So it's in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. It's not in John. Exactly. It's sort of in John. Look at John, turn to John 13 in your Bible. I want to show you where, when I say sort of, but not quite. It's like, oh, but they didn't go into details. John 13. Look at that and tell me what's going on in John 13. Yes, ma'am.
They're at the Last Supper.
And this is where Jesus did all of that, but we don't have the words of him actually doing it there. So what happens first? The disciples come in, and then what happens?
He washes
their feet. You know why they had to wash their feet? Because here's how they would have done a meal back in that day. They would come in and there would have been some low shelvings or tables, very low on the ground. And they would recline at the table, like this. Here'd be the table. And guess where their feet are? There's another person that's kind of laying next to me. And guess where my feet are? And I've taken my sandals off outside. Because they're full of what?
Sand
and dust and all that. So the first thing that happens, come inside, a servant washes your feet.
in a home. The host makes sure there's someone there to do that. So that when you recline, you have clean feet that won't get the clothes of the other people dirty. It won't be in their face. It won't be up against their skin. You'll have clean feet. Isn't that weird? But this is kind of how they often ate. And the food would be out here. And, you know, or maybe they would be like this, sitting at the table. But they would often be like this, evidently. But, and they could be like this. Or they could go back and forth. But they were on the floor. And the food out in front of them. So they got their bare feet. No socks, just bare feet. No socks back in this day. We're talking 2,000 years ago. Okay. So who washes the feet?
Jesus.
He takes on the role of a servant. But he's actually the host. It's typically the host wouldn't be the one washing the feet. And this is where Jesus is trying to teach them true leadership. A leader is a servant. A leader doesn't expect everybody else to wait on him or her. They are ready to serve the others. Okay? It's a big, 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 big deal. And Jesus is really trying to help them understand that. And of course, as you keep on reading, Peter's all upset that his Lord, Jesus, is washing feet. That's a pauper's job. That's a slave's job, so to speak. I don't want you washing my feet, Jesus. And then Jesus says, well, if you don't want to wash your feet, then you'll have nothing to do with me. And then Peter says, well, give me a shower then. Not just my feet, but all of me. And then they go in with that. And then we have the whole episode. And they're doing the Passover. You can tell they're doing this meal. Because then what happens? Jesus says what? As you read on. One of you is going to betray me. And then they go, what did he say? Wonder who that is. And of course, who knows who it is? Judas. Jesus and Judas know who it is. I think it takes Judas a while to kind of catch on. But, you know, and then Jesus tells, we keep on reading, and Jesus tells Judas, do what you must. Do what you're going to do. Get on with it. And eventually Judas leaves. Okay. So then we have, then he goes out to the Garden of Gethsemane. And then that's when the priests show up and Jesus is arrested. Judas has gone out to get the priest and all this kind of stuff. And that's when he betrays Jesus with the kiss. Because I guess they worked it out. Whoever the one I give a kiss to, you know, not we're done. We're talking about one of these kisses where it's kind of like peace of the Lord be with you, kind of an embrace kind of thing. Whoever it is that I do that with, that'll be the one. That'll be Jesus. Because Jesus, back in that day, must have looked just like everybody else. They couldn't always know for sure who it was. So Judas and the priest say, all right, I'll make sure you know. And then the priest said, arrest him. And the soldiers arrest Jesus. And then it goes to the cross. But it doesn't have the words of institution. Remember the words of institution, Dart. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. And after he broke it, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body. And then he took the cup. He gave it to his disciples, saying, take, drink, all of you. This cup is the New Testament, my blood shed for you. So those are the words of institution. So that's the reason we use that phrase. He's the word to institute something is to start something. Okay? You could institute a party. To have a party. You could institute a football game, basketball game. Sometimes you'll hear the phrase, and so instituted a riot. Or they started a riot, is what you're really saying. So that's the words of institution. Sometimes they're called the words of consecration because we're taking the elements of the bread and the wine or the grape juice and consecrating them and basically setting that bread and that
wine or grape juice apart from all the other wines and all the other grape juice for the purpose right here, right now, for this celebration. I carry a private communion set with me, most pastors do. And whenever I use that, sometimes I know I'm going to use it, sometimes I don't know. It turned out to be a good thing to maybe share communion in the home or in the hospital or with this person. And then I will consecrate that wafer and that one cup for the use for that person at that time. So that's kind of what we're talking about. So you've got all that down, right? So what are the characteristics? And we got, where is that found? Matthew, Mark, Luke. And then where, you've got Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Where is the fourth place it's found?
1 Corinthians 11:23-26.
Yes, and that's where Jesus explains to Paul how this all took place. Right? So kind of a third person kind of thing. Now, number 14 is one of the most important questions about both communion. Knowing that certain spiritual benefits are received when we partake of Holy Communion. You know what it means by partake? What does that mean, partake? That's a kind of a weird word. Kathy, what does partake mean?
Like take in?
Take in. If you participate in Holy Communion, if you celebrate Holy Communion, you take part in it, it's participating. Okay? Knowing that, okay, what are you receiving when you receive Holy Communion? What four things do you receive? Yes, sir.
With the body receives the blood, with the bread, the body receives the bread, with the blood you receive the blood.
Just reverse it. With the bread you receive the body. And with the wine you receive the blood. Is that how you wrote it? I didn't hear that time you said it.
Yeah, I just heard that.
Okay. Yeah, good. So someone's going to give you a wafer, right? And with that wafer, you also are receiving the body of Jesus, right? And someone's going to give you, you know, you're going to reach into the tray, and you're going to receive then a cup of, and with that, you're going to receive the blood of Jesus. Four, that's reading that number of 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, do you understand that in the Catholic Church, they teach and believe that the bread and the wine are changed into the body and the blood at the words of consecration. Whenever the priest says, on the night in which our Lord was betrayed, he took bread, he took wine, and so forth. At that point, the bread is changed into corpus, Latin word for body of Christ. And the blood is changed into, I'm sorry, the wine is changed into the blood. So when you go to Holy Communion in the Catholic Church, what do you receive according to their teaching? The body and the blood. You only receive two things. See? Now, if you go to La Croix or to Abbey Road Christian Church, or to First Baptist, or you know the kind of churches, they believe that the bread and the grape juice, in most of their cases, only represent or symbolize the body of Christ and the blood of Christ. They represent. So in those churches, what do you receive? When the bread comes around, what do you receive? The bread and the grape juice, or in some cases maybe wine, but typically it's only grape juice that's offered. So you see, in the Lutheran Church, you receive all four. So why do we teach that? How would you explain that? Because it's not unusual that you can have a friend that you'd be talking about Holy Communion, and you say, well, why do you all believe that? Why do we believe that? Anybody? I'm like, give it a shot. Let's say you're walking down the street with your friend. He'll be in and they say, what would you try to tell him? And I don't know what works. What would you try? In your own words. Jesus died to save our sinners. Okay. And what about all this stuff with the bread and the wine? Why do you think you receive, you know, with the bread you also receive the body? And with the wine you also receive the blood. So why do we believe that?
Yeah.
Anybody want to take a stab at it? Ready? Want to take a stab at it? Why do you think we believe that? No one knows. What would you say to somebody? Here's what we say. Did Jesus take the bread and say, now I'm changing this into my body? Did he say that? What words did he say? What did he say? He took the bread and he said, this is my body. Right? And then did he say, this represents my body? Or did he say, pretend this is my body? Did he say that? And nowhere do we see that in words. Yeah, he said, it is, right? So does it say anywhere that he took the cup, which means he took the wine, the cup that had wine in it? Did he say, now I'm changing this, when you get this, it's going to be my blood, I'm changing this into my blood. Could he have done that? Yes, he could have. Where do we have evidence of that? Do you remember it? Yes? He turned water into wine, didn't he? So he could have easily changed his wine into blood. There's nothing. He didn't say I'm doing that. He didn't say that happened. They passed that cup of wine around, and that's what they drank. But he said, this is my blood. Right? So, and he didn't say it represents, he didn't say I'm changing it into. So you're left with those four things. With that wafer, with that bread, you're also receiving the body, because Jesus said, it's my body. So it's a matter of faith. It makes absolutely... So what Cody can say, it doesn't make any sense. It really doesn't make... It's kind of weird. But we just know that Jesus didn't say it's changed into, didn't say it's representing, just said it is. So we believe that when the wine, when the wafer comes around, we're also receiving the body. And when the wine or the grape juice, in our church you have a choice, but you're one of those you receive, you're also with it receiving the blood. Yes, ma'am.
If there was ever a debate between it's hard to explain. How would you explain if someone was saying that drinking blood was okay, and then they looked at this Bible verse and it says, this is my blood. Nobody would drink blood. I'm just saying, why would...
I don't know of any Christian ritual where drinking blood's a good thing. Or that would have been a common practice.
It's just talking about pagans.
Yeah, there could be some pagan stuff where blood was.
You think they try to pretend they're Christian? Like, if you're Christian, it's good.
It would, if I were debating that, I would say, I would try to concede to them. You may be able to find evidence that some people think, and maybe there were some places where people were drinking blood. But that doesn't mean that that's what Jesus is intending here. Because he didn't say, I'm changing this into blood. Nor do any of the scriptures, and there's more than one, there's actually four, none of them give testimony that the wine was changed into blood. If that would have happened, don't we think that that would have been recorded? That would have been... So I believe that the evidence doesn't demonstrate that it was changed into blood.
behind the debate.
It wouldn't be an argument I'd want to have with someone that would ask
about
it.
Yeah. But it's not an unlikely debate.
Yeah.
That has been debated down through the ages. That's the reason the Catholics believe what they believe, and the Baptists and Methodists and Presbyterians, so forth, and believe what they believe, and the Lutherans believe what we believe.
I think we just believe it through blind faith, like a child.
I think,
we don't try to translate it like a human wants to change it to make it safe. We just believe it.
In my mind, Lutheran is the simplest thing to believe.
It's because it's straight from the Bible. We're kind of like change it to something else. It's what we think. It's just reading.
Yeah, we don't add any words to it. We just take them as they are. And he didn't say, I'm changing it into. He didn't say, this represents. And you can't, you can even go back to the original. He would have spoken it in Arabic, but it's written in Koine Greek, right? Either one of those languages that you go back to, you would have to really work at it to add a bunch of words to talk about representing or changing into. Okay. Yes, ma'am?
Why would they still believe that?
This is what we've always believed and we've always been taught.
When you said, like, Catholics?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
There is a, we were taught by one of our professors at the seminary that sometimes the Catholic Mass, which is a full-blown worship service with Holy Communion, sometimes they would be doing it every hour, on the hour, and people would be coming and going. And sometimes a priest would either have long readings to read in the scripture readings, or maybe he would have a long homily. So, and there would be a lot of people there for communion. So he would have to hurry things along to finish on time. And when you say, back in the day when they spoke Latin, and all the priests always had to speak Latin until about the 1970s or so, then they changed that. They started speaking English. But in Latin, if you say the words corpus, and then the words, if I were really smart and sharp, I would recite these words of institution in Latin. And if I say it fast, some of those words begin to run together. And what some people were hearing was a phrase, hocus pocus, corpus, okay? But all those words together, they were hearing hocus pocus. And there were signs being made over, and they were believing that magic was happening. And that's where the phrase hocus pocus, and making a sign over a hat or something, and you're changing a rabbit into a flower. That's where that phrase comes from. It's from the Catholic institution. The priest saying it very rapidly. I said, if I were good, I could do it, but I'm not that good. Yes, ma'am. Kind of magic words of magic to change something into something else. And they picked that up from the priest, changing the blood, the wine, into the blood. It didn't really happen, but they believe it in their minds that it was happening. Yeah. So if the priest spills wine after the words of consecration, big problem. If a wafer is dropped, big issue. The reason the Catholics, you know what genuflecting is? Genuflecting. Going into the center aisle of the Catholic Church, and a Catholic will always do this. In the center aisle, will always do that. And then they'll go into their pew. That's called genuflecting. The reason they do that is because the unused body of Christ is still up at the altar. So they really believe that remains of Christ's body are in the altar. And that's what they're bowing down to. Because I asked a question when I went through Catholic adult instruction class. Because out of respect, I was genuflecting, and I finally said, I wonder why we do that. I thought it was just a Catholic thing to do in the center aisle. I didn't have a clue. I finally asked. I said, oh, the body of Christ is, of course, we should have done that. That's how they believe that. Don, could you go get inside, is the office door open? There are some mint candies in that little cup.
Barb's desk?
No, it's on
the peppermints?
First desk.
Yeah.
Right. Right on the first desk as you walk in. You're talking about it. Everything? Or just in all?
Everything.
It would be hard to explain all that. Thank you very much. Oh, did we knock your side over? Sometimes, in some cases, not a whole lot. In general, we try to say, but it's not always the most accurate, but in general, we feel like that the Lutheran Church emphasizes faith over words. In other words, we're not saved by anything we do. There's nothing we can do to get God to love us any more than He does. And if you look at Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, that is kind of the absolute bottom line summary of the Lutheran faith. So go ahead and turn to that. So that's a good question. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. It's going to say something like, "For by grace are you saved through what?"
Faith.
Circle faith. You should really highlight these two. You really want to highlight 8, 9, and 10. Chapter 2, verses 8 and 9 and 10. "For by grace are you saved through faith, through no works of our own, lest anybody should boast." In other words, we cannot boast about how good we are, no matter what, because that's not what saves. Our works, our good works, no matter how good they are, do not save us. I'll give you a preview of a sermon I'm going to preach Sunday afternoon with a great, great man. And I said, "It's not the one I say it with." I've said it before. But there's going to be a lot of praise of Dr. David Crow, an incredibly wonderful man. He had his faults, had his weaknesses, like all of us do. But he was one of those genuinely, really good guys. And there would be a bunch of us. There would be a state Supreme Court judge. There would be all kinds of dignitaries talking about the wonderful way this man lived his life. No question about it. And after all that is said and done, I'm going to say, none of that amounts to a hill of beans when it comes to how God looks upon him. None of it. Did it please God? Yeah, but did it save him for eternity? Absolutely not. Nothing that we do, I don't care how good we are, it doesn't amount to a hill of beans. The only hill that counts when it comes to our relationship with Jesus is the hill he died on. And that hill's name was what? Calvary. Also called Golgotha. That was at the top of Calvary. Okay? That's the hill that counts. My hill, you know, doesn't amount to a hill of beans. It's an old expression. I grew up with that. Anybody ever hear of that? Doesn't amount to a hill of beans. Well, you ever have a hill of beans? You know what hill of beans are? You plant beans often in a little mound in a garden. And, you know, that's a hill of beans. Well, Dr. Crow, and it's a terrific man, believe me. And nothing that I do, nothing that any of us do, amounts to hell beings when it took to God for my eternity. What does count is what Jesus did. And he died for me. So, we're not saved by our good works. We're saved by all that Jesus did. So, and that takes faith. So what saves us is our faith. That is the central part of our Lutheran teaching. Now, do other churches teach that? Yes, they do. But it's not necessarily, at least down through history, always emphasized as much. That's what reformed the church back in the day. That's the reason Dr. Martin Luther started asking questions in the Catholic Church. Because of his questions and his stance on that topic and on that verse and other verses like it, he was kicked out of the Catholic Church because they would not agree with his teachings. And that's until he was protesting that teaching against that. He was protesting that. Well, you can't emphasize grace that much. You gotta, you need to be caught up in, you know, coming to confession and doing all these things and worshiping the relics and buying indulgences, all the stuff that was going on then. And Luther said, no, you do not. None of that saves us. Only what Jesus did saves us, and we have that by grace. So by grace are you saved through faith. That is the central point of the Protestant Reformation. So if anything is the central teachings in the Lutheran Church, it would be that. But I also don't want you to hear me saying, yeah, none of the other churches teach that. Because you can hear great sermons by great preachers that are other denominations that preach it very well. Henry Nouwen is a great hero of mine. He was a Catholic priest. And he taught grace better than I can ever think of teaching it. If I quote him, I can teach it as well as he did. But I quote a Catholic priest when I'm quoting Dr. Keller. Does that make sense? So down through the years, down through the ages, we've all kind of grown with each other, and we've had a lot of debates. Use the term debate. There've been a lot of debates over this stuff. And sometimes it drives me crazy. But sometimes I think we're splitting hairs. And I hate the denominational thing. Jesus prayed in John 17. Father is praying to his Father, and the whole chapter is a prayer to his Father. And part of a phrase, if I'm saying it right, Father, help them all be one, as we are, so that they will know that we are one. And when he talks about them, he's talking about the disciples and all the people out here in the world believing these things. Because as long as we stay divided like we are with religion in this world, most of the people go, really? Did I really want to have anything to do with that? I don't think so. Why would I get caught up in that confusion and all that debate and all that stuff? So more and more people have nothing to do with religion and with the church, denominations, so they just kind of go their own way. And I think it breaks God's heart that we will not come together in a more unified way. Now, I wish I were smart enough and bright enough and sharp enough to be able to come onto the world and say, we need to get it together, people. And everybody would go, wow, I guess we do. That's not happening. So, unless God raises me up and puts extra new words in my mouth, it's not going to happen. But I keep hoping it will. I don't think, by the way, we're talking about being way off the topic, that Jesus is going to come back to that. You know he's coming back. We all teach that. I don't think he's going to come back until we figure that out. Because I think he's kind of sent us off to, ever have your parents send you off to your room? With your sisters or your brothers or, you know, whatever. Go to your room and close it. And when you get it figured out, it didn't come out. That ever happen?
Or make the boys go work it out together.
Go work it out together. And when you get it figured out, come and talk to me.
Yeah.
Then we'll talk about whatever we want to talk about. But don't come back until you get it. I think Jesus has kind of said, you know, you guys, figure it out. I gave you my word. I've given you my sacraments, Holy Communion and baptism. I've given you my real presence. I'm here. I'm willing to help you with that. But as long as you keep, you know, bickering and dickering about all this stuff, I'm not coming. figure it out. So, well, you've heard kind of, you've heard my heart. That's the reason I'm writing a book, Religion's Not Worth the Hassle. Because I think it breaks the personal relationship. It breaks it down. It makes it difficult. It gets in the way. And it causes the church to close its door to the people that are trying to figure it out. And maybe you aren't quite getting it exactly right. The church says, well, we can't do that because you're this or you're that. And maybe you won't even talk to them. It drives me crazy. And it's gotten me in a lot of discussions over the years with my brethren in the ministry, but that's okay. So, did I answer your question? It's a very good question. Now, notice, I said Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. I want you to make sure you see verse 10. We Lutherans can make the mistake of omitting verse 10. But verse 10 says, however, we're created to do good works. Because we are God's, this is the verse I use, you're a piece of work. You're a piece of work that God created to do good works. You're part, you're God's craftsmanship. I tried to tell the high school girls at Saxony this morning, I was asked to have their devotions, they were leaving. It was fun to talk about Katie football, and I was on the first state team and all that stuff, and how we felt, and you'll never forget this. But I said, each one of you have been given very special talents. Go for it. Don't worry about it. You know, play your position, play it well, and go for it. And I said, and all of us are there with you. I said, I'm in this book, Katie Nation, but I'm only in a team picture. I didn't score any touchdowns. I was not that big a deal of a player. I stayed on varsity for 3 years, which was kind of not easy to do. You had to keep grades up, and you had to function strong enough to be able to stay on a team and to stay on. I was always on the traveling squad. But I got the same ring. I got the same letter. I got the same record. I'm always, whenever they went, that first state championship of Katy, Texas back, I always get to be part of that. And they don't go, yeah, well, it was Dwayne Fossil that scored the points, and it was Charlie Schaefer that scored the winning touchdown in the state. They never do that. They just make us all one team. And my point of that this morning was that, and by the way, guess who won the game of life against Satan, against eternal death, and against, you know, the condemnation of sin? Guess who won that game? Jesus. Did I win that game? No. But if I'm on a team with Jesus, guess what? I get the victory. Because I'm on his team. Not everybody that played in sports in the Olympics, played on all those teams, not everybody scored. Maybe some didn't get off the bench all that much. But they got the same medal. They got the same recognition as the rest of the team. Isn't that cool? And so, we're on Team Jesus, we win. We get the same victory Jesus got. As he scored the points for us. Score! Score Team Jesus, and we all get a point. A victory and eternal life. Then I didn't. I just sat on a bench. And watched, you know, and Jesus died. Jesus did all the work. He said, I know. But it's yours. I want you to be with me. I want you on my team forever. So that's Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. Now verse 10 is like, so what? So what that we have that great relationship? So what that we're on Team Jesus? He's really saying, go for it. I've given you a talent. I've given you abilities. I've given you intellect. I've given you spiritual gifts. And use those now, not to get me to love you, because that part's taken care of. That I already love you. Now, since I do love you, and we love each other, go for it. When you hook up with a girl one of these days, you can't stop doing enough for her. It'll drive you and your parents crazy. They're going to go, really? You're going to spend that much money on her? Come on, Dad. Come on. Right? Yeah, right. That's all right. Right answer now. Right answer. A big shrug. You got to be kidding. Right answer.
That's a raised flash.
Yeah. And no. But you can't, and that's where God wants us. He wants us to enjoy the relationship. Not to worry about it. Not to always be. I had a 20-year-old young man in my office Sunday, desperate to get right with God. I mean, he was a good-looking guy. He looked strong. I wouldn't want to take him on, you know, with me, I'm sure. But he was so anxious, and he was afraid something was going to happen to him physically, and he wasn't right with God. And he wanted to know what he needed to do to get right with God. And I basically said, there's not a thing you can do, I'm sorry. I just kind of let that kind of, and he just got more agitated. And I said, and by the way, there's nothing I can do either. I said, there's nothing you and I can do to get right with God. That's the reason we have Jesus. Because God makes us right with Himself. That's the Lutheran teaching. That's a scriptural teaching, but the Lutheran Church tries to put a magnifying glass on that teaching and say, yes, this is what it is. And sometimes, maybe the other denominations, at least in their doctrinal teachings, don't emphasize that quite as much. Doesn't mean they don't, but it's a big deal in the Lutheran Church. I think maybe if there's any unity happening, there's a little bit more of that general teaching like that going on. But I love to listen to Rick Warren. I love to listen to Andy Stanley. I love to listen to all those different preachers and all these different denominations. Because, by the way, they describe grace is amazing. Wow, that is rich. And I use their stories. I quote them. So I think there's a lot more great teaching about grace because the scripture teaches it. It's all over the place. For some reason, back in the day, the Catholic Church just couldn't pull it out of it. They couldn't do it. I think they work at it better now than they used to. I do. The reason I know that is because I'm in Catholic churches a lot. Because my older son married a Catholic. And I have two Catholic grandkids that we've gone to First Communion, and so we're around. So I'm around some Catholic priests. And we had a man from Kenya that was a priest at St. Vincent for a while. Cool guy. We'd have him come and meet with our teams going to Kenya so they could hear the accent and hear some real Swahili words from a Kenyan. But he's been moved on. I think he's in Western Missouri now. But he's from Kenya. And it was fun to talk to him about Jesus and grace. So that part's getting better. If we could just get rid of some of this denominationalism. Makes me sound like a reading liberal, doesn't it?
No, it's good.
They
have to not be afraid of it. My two closest friends, one's Catholic, I talk to her every day. And the other one is mm-hmm. studying to be a Baptist mm-hmm. pastor. And I always refer to him or ask him for advice.
Yeah.
Which doesn't even make sense because I don't know anything about Lutheranism.
So Hunter, did I answer your question? So whenever you're trying to help someone see what we teach and believe, go to Ephesians 2, 8, 9, and 10. Don't forget 10. Because works count in a way, but they don't count for our salvation. They're there as a result of our salvation. And sometimes if we're not doing anything, then maybe we ought to review our lives and say, what more can I be doing? Not to get more right with God. We can't do that. A very, very great leader of St. Andrew Lutheran Church. I don't think he'd mind. Well, I'm not going to use his name. He's now deceased. I'm not going to use his name. I really have his permission. I wish I would have asked him for it. So I said, can I quote you? Because he had terminal cancer. He was dying. I was visiting with him in his home. And I knew him really well because he was a leader in the church. I spent a lot of time just in church and different stuff. And so, and I have a devotion with him. And I noticed, and he was a fun guy, kind of. And he was a lifelong Lutheran. But he had a rosary around his neck. Big, you know what a rosary is? It's the wooden beads, usually wooden, that sometimes has a cross or a crucifix on it. And it's the rosary that the Catholics use to pray with. And they pray the rosary. And it takes them through the praying to Mary. And they're praying to God. And they're sometimes saying the Apostles' Creed. There's several different things that help them stay focused on what they're doing. And he had this Catholic rosary. And I joked around, I said, so if I look around, am I going to find a Buddha sitting around? He said, no, I didn't go that far. He said, I just want to make sure I have all my bases covered. So he was trying to make sure he wasn't leaving anything out. I said, that's crazy. He said, well, I just want to make sure I have it right. And I stopped, it stopped me dead in my tracks. And I looked at him and I said, I can tell you for sure you don't. And he took the rosary. I said, you can leave that on. It doesn't make any difference. That's not what makes it right. He said, you and I said, I can't get it right. Same discussion I had, you know, with the young man in my office. I said, I can't get it right. But what you and I can count on is that Jesus got it right for us. That's what he said. And it's so human for us to forget that. Because when stuff starts going wrong in our lives, we wonder, what am I doing wrong? That God is punishing me. And then we start working on trying to get it right. And God just says, settle. Settle down. What he really says is, be still. And let me be God. Let me, that's in Psalm 46. Be still and know that I am God. Just settle. Sometimes in traffic, Jean has to put her hand over on my leg. All settle. Because either it's a huge traffic jam, I'm crazy, or I'm lost, I'm agitated, and the garment's not working, whatever. And I get, and every now and then I thank God for putting his hand on her shoulder and saying, let me be God. Take a deep breath. Let me be God. So, got me way off the topic there, but I hope it was helpful. Did you have your hand up, Maggie? Just taking a stretch. Doing a little yoga over there. It's 6:15. We need to almost stop, don't we? All right. We got hung up here. We'll keep reviewing. Okay, work on your essays. Bring them back next week. You got to figure it out for Justin. You got Justin's essay.
I'll talk to Mr.
Okay. All right. And as we close, just to fill in one more blank, if you don't. What answer do you have down for 14a? Who is really present in Holy Communion? Jesus. Have any of you seen the movie E.T.? I call Holy Communion, it's okay if you quote me on this, as long as you quote me right. I call the real presence of Jesus Christ in Holy Communion the E.T. moment. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? In E.T.? What? Yeah? No, I think you're
right.
Yeah, good. You're close, I think. Yeah, you remember after Elliot gets... After Elliot rescues E.T., and they get through all the stuff, and they get to the mothership, and E.T.'s, it's obvious E.T.'s about ready to get on the ship, and he's going to leave and go home. And it kind of dawns on Elliot, it's like, man, he's leaving. I'll never see this guy again. And they become very, very close friends. I mean, really tight. They become really tight. And Elliot is pretty, you know, upset about this. And what does E.T. say? Leah. Here's E.T. His finger. Remember the red glowing finger? You know, when everything, you know, like, finger would glow and it's like, ooh. You know? All that, you know, that's kind of like, okay. And Elliot is, you know, going, you know, really upset. Elliot, that's okay. I will always be what? I will always be with you. And he reaches over and he touches Elliot's fingers. What happens to Elliot's finger? It also glows red, right? Now this is what you got to quote to get me right on it. Now take that to a much higher level. And we have Jesus promising, I will always be with you. I will never leave you or forsake. I will be with you to the end of the ages, he says. Which one picture? Yeah. He's here. And Holy Communion is that physical sign that he's giving us. And the reality that Jesus is here in this sacrament. Forgiving us, assuring us of the forgiveness. He's there in his words, a promise. Take, eat, take, drink. This is my body, this is my blood. I forgive you of all your sins. He is so present. I'm running out of time to do this. I keep wanting to do it. Show up in sandals and take my sandals off. After I consecrate the elements, or as I'm consecrated somewhere along the line, because I'm staying on holy ground, because Christ is present in it, sir. Just as real as he was at the burning bush with Moses, and what did he tell Moses to do? Take off your shoes because you're standing on holy ground. So yes, it's Jesus that's really present in Holy Communion. The other churches don't teach that. I don't remember it being taught in the Catholic Church. I need to double check that. I know the other denominations outside of us don't teach that. Okay? Doesn't make them bad or wrong, but just that's what we teach. Lord, thank you for all of this tonight. I thank you for each one of these young people and how very special you've made them by drawing them and choosing them to be on your team. None of us are left out. And I just pray that you will touch hearts and minds with deep faith, along with your incredible love that you have for each one of us. And that you will just help us to remember as we do come to communion, the fullness of what's going on. It's more than just going through religious motions. It's really receiving you in that sacrament. So, as weird as all of it sounds, as we've talked about tonight, we thank you for the miracle and the fullness that happens in all of this. So, be with these young people as they work on their essays. Give them words in their hearts and their minds to put on paper that will help them to express their faith in wonderful, deep, rich ways. We ask that you go with us as we go to worship or wherever it is that we go. Guide us safely. As we eventually end up in bed tonight, give us a restful night of slumber and sleep and awaken us to a brand new day that you're already preparing for each one of us. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray as we go. Thank you. I apologize for taking away your